know, that survival gap is all the more disturbing when you realize that white women actually have more breast cancer than black women. Yet when black women get diagnosed with breast cancer, it's at a later stage and they die at a much greater rate. So St. Barnabas Hospital in the Tremont section of the Bronx is taking health care right to the people who need it most.
It might be a death sentence for me.
That's what Patricia Moore says might have happened had she not gotten her breast cancer diagnosed and treated at an early stage. The early diagnosis started, as it often does, with a mammogram. What's unusual about Patricia's case is where it was done. Patricia didn't get her mammogram in a doctor's office or hospital. She walked into this mobile van parked on a Bronx street.
It's really an in and out thing. They make you feel very comfortable.
And that's the key. Breast surgeon Dr. Burke Peterson heads the St. Barnabas Outreach Program. He says offering health care like mammograms in places like hospitals isn't enough.
Sometimes intimidating to actually get the health care in these large settings where sometimes there are language barriers and cultural barriers in these large institutions. So it really becomes important to actually engage in what I call taking health care to the people.
So the St. Barnabas van parks outside churches, beauty parlors, community centers.
We've started to pick up our cancers much earlier, which has not only led to the ultimate outcome of better survival, but we have more women who no longer need mastectomies.
When you can just walk and feel comfortable and have a test done, saves more lives every day, every minute, every hour, every year.
We've asked Dr. Ernest Patty to join us. He is a senior attending physician of emergency medicine at St. Barnabas Hospital in the Bronx. Dr. Patty, thank you very much for joining us. We appreciate it. How dangerous is this? We know that they're coming up through this tiny little capsule. One of the big concerns is low blood pressure, correct?
Well, part of the problem is they're upright the entire ride, plus the capsule rotates a number of times. It's probably like one of the wildest carnival rides you'd be on. They're in a confined, enclosed space. They're prone to claustrophobia. They're prone to hypotension or getting dizzy from the blood flow being pushed towards their extremities.
The pediatric unit at St. Barnabas Hospital no longer closes at midnight. Now your children can get 24-hour treatment 7 days a week.
It gives the children a dedicated place to be. I know they'll be seen in a child-friendly environment and seen quickly.
Dr. David Listman is the director of the Pediatric Emergency Department, and he says the expansion of hours was years in the making.
Get them in, out, hopefully back to their beds at home.
It looks like a new hotel, but it's not. You're looking at one of the rooms in St. Barnabas Hospital's brand new Center for Sleep Medicine.
Completely painless. It's relaxing.
Millions suffer from sleep disorders like sleep apnea or when you stop breathing.
It affects their mood, concentration, ability to go to work and have normal daily activities.
He says controlling it increases your quality of life and may reduce your stroke and heart attack risk.
Hasta un 20% de la población estadounidense padece de apnea del sueño, un trastorno respiratorio debido a episodios repetidos de obstrucción o colapso de las vías aéreas. Episodios que ocurren cuando la persona duerme. La persona, literalmente, deja de respirar.
So it's a huge percentage.
Es un porcentaje realmente alto. Existe un bloqueo en el tejido de las vías respiratorias en el cuello y en la parte posterior de la garganta que no permite el paso del aire.
El cuello es parte del útero que aguanta el fetus adentro. Y si está abriendo y cortando, ese quizás significa un más alto riesgo de un parto prematuro. Entonces lo que encontraron en ese estudio es que con este tratamiento bajaron el riesgo de parto prematuro de 50% más o menos.
Well, Bill, it turns out almost every single senior who was rushed to this hospital today did not have air conditioning at home and had their windows shut. Doctors say ventilation is key, so if you don't have AC, at least open the window because hot air moving is still better than no air.
I felt cramps on the left side of my body.
When 66-year-old Graciela Correa was rushed to St. Barnabas Hospital tonight because of the heat, one of the first things doctors did was lower her body temperature the old-fashioned way with a spray of water in front of a fan.
When the air blows on it, it helps the water evaporate, which cools the temperature down.
While the best way to fight fire is with water, lots of it, Dr. Ernest Patty, the head of emergency medicine here, offers more tips for keeping cool.
As well as cold compress. surfaces, take a couple of frequent baths, go into the sprinkler, hose yourself down once in a while just to cool yourself off.
In muggy, hot weather like this, it doesn't take much to succumb to the brutal heat.
Going out in the heat, even for 7, 8, 10, 15 minutes, is going to affect you. You're going to feel it.
Bronx parents may want to change the way they strap their kids into the car. The American Academy of Pediatrics released new guidelines for car seats.
The leading cause of injury in children over 4 years of age is motor vehicle accidents.
Anne Marie McDonald is the trauma program manager at St. Barnabas Hospital. She says how you buckle your child in could have a big impact in a crash.
If you're rear facing, it distributes the energy from the collision through the entire body as opposed to just head, neck, and the cervical spine.
Bronxite Eliana Mendoza feels lucky to be healthy and alive.
I was afraid of finding out something that I didn't want to hear. And then come to find out that it was the best thing I did.
Mendoza says 2 years ago, she started having stomach pains, but was scared to get checked out. A month ago, she came to St. Barnabas Hospital and got a colonoscopy. She had a polyp removed before it possibly turned to this, cancer.
I feel relief. I feel comfortable. I feel healthier. I feel happier.
Dr. Andrea Culliford is gastroenterology division chief at St. Barnabas. She's trying to get the word out to Bronxites about screenings, especially now during colorectal cancer awareness month.
It's the second leading cause of death in America from cancer.
Dr. Culliford says if caught early, this cancer is treatable. She says the worst part of a colonoscopy is probably the day before the 20-minute screening.
You have to clean out your colon. Or do a colon cleanse. And the day of the test, you get sedation for the procedure, so you don't feel anything.
On her first routine colonoscopy, a standard protocol for colon cancer screening, doctors discovered 52-year-old Ilania Mendoza had a polyp. It was an abnormal growth of tissue in her colon that, if left undetected, could have turned into cancer down the road. Other than concerns about a family history, with no symptoms for Mendoza, it's something that might not have been caught. Mendoza's doctor says it's a good thing her polyp was discovered.
Things like weight loss that's unintentional, rectal bleeding, abdominal pain, and when they have those symptoms, then we really need to investigate by doing a diagnostic test called a colonoscopy.
Something everyone should keep in mind is that diet can also play a major role in colon cancer risk as well.
You really want to eat a high fiber diet, fresh fruits, vegetables, and 25 grams of fiber a day. The link there is mainly with high cholesterol, obesity, and high fat diets.
In 1971, there were 3 million cancer survivors. Nearly 40 years later, the number jumping to almost 12 million, this according to federal health officials.
And joining us now, Dr. Ernest Patti, senior attending physician of emergency medicine at St. Barnabas Hospital. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Heather and Craig.
So the obvious question, why the increase in survival rate? Why is that happening? How is it happening?
It's exciting news, and I think there's a number of factors that are contributing to the increased survivability. One's probably early detection. The other one is definitely better diagnostic studies. Mm-hmm. Education is out there as well. Healthier behavioral habits. And people are paying more attention to things that could be contributing to the increased incidence of cancer, such as smoking cessation. These are all hot topics today.
British production company has chosen the Bronx as the location for their next documentary. Film is about life in the emergency room and will be shot at St. Barnabas Hospital. They say they'll be focusing mainly on trauma centers. Trauma director at St. Barnabas says the film company couldn't have picked a better hospital.
All communities are unique, and Bronx has its own uniqueness. I think that it's a diverse population here, which is a plus, and it can also add to the challenges that we encounter on a daily basis.
All of a sudden, I started getting this chest pain. It was very hard, very deep, and it started just like crawling up to my neck.
Dr. Ruben Silverman is director of cardiology here at St. Barnabas Hospital. He says Ms. Reyes's case is all too common. He hopes to raise awareness now, especially for women during American Heart Month.
One of every three women will die of heart disease. One of every 30 women will die of breast cancer.
Dr. Silverman says women often do not exhibit classic heart disease symptoms like chest pain and chest pressure.
Many women will present with very vague symptoms, perhaps of some shortness of breath, fatigue, nausea.
Fordham Tremont is the behavioral health arm of St. Barnabas Hospital. They've been collecting items for the giveaway since September. This is the second year the drive is being held, but the success of the event means there will likely be more to come.
This is a really wonderful day. I mean, for so many of us in the field of mental health services, it's a day that just sort of reconnects you in a very deep way with working in the community.
But doctors here at St. Barnabas Hospital say this weather is no joke, and the consequences of not bundling up are no laughing matter.
I had a homeless person who came in, lost, I believe, three fingers and about four of his toes because he was sleeping on the street, not dressed warmly enough.
Dr. Patty says it's important to wear as many layers as possible, that is, if you must be outdoors. He says to pay close attention to your head, fingers, and toes, making sure they're properly covered.
Drink one Four Loko, and it's like having three beers, a cup of coffee, and a Red Bull. Doctors say this caffeinated alcoholic drink is a dangerous combination and putting a lot of kids in the emergency room.
They're both intoxicated as well as aggressive.
Dr. David Listman is in charge of the pediatric ER at St. Barnabas Hospital and says mixing caffeine with alcohol can be deadly.
You're feeling stimulated, you're feeling pepped up, your heart's going, and yet your judgment is off. You're intoxicated at the same time, but you may not realize just how intoxicated you are.
Flip-flops are cute, cheap, and convenient, but many come with a painful price. Dr. Andrew Campbell is a podiatrist at St. Barnabas Hospital. He says people who wear flip-flops could eventually develop painful tendonitis in the arch of the foot or in the back of the heel.
The thong-style flip-flops are probably the worst because they're the least secure to the foot.
The popular summer shoe is bringing more patients into his Bronx office.
Patients do come in summertime with more heel pain sometimes, and they don't understand why.
Malik Smith is in the seventh grade and had trouble seeing and reading at school.
In my class, when I was looking at the board, it would be harder for me to see than any other kids.
So his mother took him to see Dr. Sandra Cohen, an eye doctor at St. Barnabas Hospital.
He didn't realize how blurry it really was, and he wasn't able to sit and read for long periods of time.
Dr. Cohen had to perform several tests to determine exactly what was wrong with Malik's eyes. After a thorough exam, she did determine that it was astigmatism.
When you have astigmatism, it's a very vague sort of discomfort visually. It could give headaches.
Dr. Cohen wrote Malik a prescription for eyeglasses, and now he's seeing more clearly. Dr. Cohen says many Bronx children have vision problems, and they go undiagnosed and untreated.
For a child, the eyes are the gateway to learning. You know, every bit of information that the brain absorbs and gathers is through the eyes. And unless you are certain that the eyes are working properly, you don't know if your child is reaching their potential.
Alzheimer's disease researchers at Columbia University found people who ate so-called brain-healthy nutrients had a 40% lower risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. Bronx geriatric specialist Dr. Joel Sender sees many Alzheimer patients and says a Mediterranean diet could be beneficial for prevention.
We believe that this has reduced the degree to which people have experienced memory loss and problems with their thinking, and that's only recent studies that suggest that there is a delay in the development of any cognitive decline.
It's almost time to go back to school, but there are things Bronx parents need to know about their child's health before sending their kids to class.
It's important to make your appointments to see the pediatrician, go to your clinic well in advance of the start of school. Kids need to be updated for their vaccines before starting kindergarten, in middle school, and their vaccines in high school now as well.
18-year-old Ignacio Martinez plays soccer for St. Raymond's High School and loves the sport. This is video of him playing last year.
I've been playing soccer since I was five.
But the South Bronx teen injured his left knee on the field last summer and has been out of the game since. Dr. Mark Silverman performed laparoscopic surgery to repair Ignacio's damaged ligaments and cartilage. Dr. Silverman made three small incisions around Ignacio's knee. A scope went into one.
And then we actually put a drain through here, and we do all the procedure through this tiny little incision.
Dr. Silverman says you can't always prevent athletic injuries, especially in contact sports, but you can condition your body to be strong enough to withstand the impact.
Proper fitness and proper stretching prior to activities is important to prevent muscle strains. Keeping the muscle strong can act as a stabilizing effect on the knee and take some of the load off these ligaments and cartilage.
Ivelisses Polanco suffers from chronic tension headaches, a dull pain that sometimes lasts several hours.
My pain, the side, the pain right here, coming down right here.
Bronx doctors say the condition is becoming more common, especially during these uncertain economic times.
Very, very common that these headaches get triggered by some serious event or lifestyle change.
Ivelisses was desperate for relief and went to Dr. James Ujunik, a specialist in oral and facial pain at St. Barnabas Hospital.
Most commonly, it involves the temporalis muscle, which is the temples, right, most commonly. But eventually, the headaches tend to involve other muscles as well.
There are things you can do to alleviate the pain of a tension headache.
Light aerobic exercise, frequent walks. There's a variety of methods that people can employ to get them to not be so stressed throughout the day.
2-year-old Ethan Feliciano appears healthy, but sometimes he can't breathe because of his asthma, and when it's bad, his mother Ingrid has to take him to the emergency room. Dr. David Lisman is the pediatric emergency physician at St. Barnabas Hospital. He examined Ethan and listened to his lungs. Dr. Lisman says there are signs that a child's asthma has become dangerous.
We see spikes with asthma in a couple of different seasons, actually over the last month or so because of the high pollen counts during the spring. There's been a lot of asthma, and in the high heat of the summer, we get spikes in asthma patients as well.